So yeah, I'm Timo from work at Ircam, the Sound Music Movement Interaction Team. But not only that, I also do music on the side and try to find a good place in that golden triangle of artistic creation, software development, and research. This position is here, of course. But there's always these fields of tension, but I think that would lead into too many details. So we can talk about the fields of tensions later, coffee or around a pint. So on the artistic side, just to get that off, I have a couple of musical projects. The most accomplished is probably the Ensemble Improvisers Orchestra, and lots of duos and trios. I do work with a couple of artists in performing arts and also in installation. So yeah, check this out. I should put the blog address here. All the works are somehow documented and announced at concatenative.net. Because for all these projects, I do use corpus space synthesis either as a musical instrument or as a technical basis to program interactive systems for other artists. And so, corpus-based concatenative synthesis. It's easier to show than to explain. So, take this one, make it a bit bigger. So, in order to create a corpus of sound, you just grab a few audio files, throw them in there, and they will get analyzed for a certain number of sound descriptors. And that gives you a multidimensional space of timbres with lots of small bits of sound, small segments that populate that space. And of course you can visualize it most easily by just projecting it to two of these sound descriptors. That's what is happening here by default. And as soon as you have that, you can, of course, browse that space. Here we've got a space of charging cable. Choose by plugging in the audio cable here. That's fault. That is mute. Let me just restart while I Okay, so you've got lots of audio descriptors projected, and the interesting thing, of course, is to browse around. Maybe let's just go on here. Because then you've got kind of best of both worlds. You've got you've got real sound in your corpus, and you can still control the kind of the selection of it, and so for compositional purposes, you retain high level control, because these sound descriptors correspond to perceptual qualities of the sound, the timbre. So you can control it in terms of high level musical descriptors and still evoke actual recorded sounds. So that is in opposition to kind of synthesis algorithms, model-based synthesis, where the synthesis model is governed by, well, the parameters of the model, which not necessarily have a direct correspondence to the resulting sound, the sound character. Okay, and so our main use is here for browsing through sound. There are other uses like audio mosaicing, that is when you control the selection of units from another audio recording. So you replace a given target recording by sounds from the corpus. Or there have been composers using corpus-based synthesis for transcription of existing sound into scores and reorchestration. Okay. But we do sound browsing, and just to finish that slide. And when the browsing is done not with mouse or so, but via gesture controllers, then this becomes, of course, a musical instrument. So, we have better luck now. Yes. Okay. And the descriptors for the moment are spectral centroid from left to right and periodicity from bottom to top, which means that the vowels end up top left and the fricatives to the right. And these would be all the noisy silent bits. Not obliged to have a homogeneous corpus. Very nice to put in various other sound sources along with it. Some wind sounds, and it's good to play the bits of sound a bit longer than they have been, and a bit smoother. Multi-touch surfaces. The one that works best at the moment is this little roly light pad block. And nicely it also displays what is in the corpus. If the light is a bit too bright here, but this is a 15x15 pixel LED full color display. So with that, and just another controller to modulate the playback parameters, length and envelope and filters. That's actually my main musical instrument that I've been playing now for 8 years. 8 years without changing the principle and the mappings too much. So actually, from the moment I stopped changing the software, I noticed that this was becoming an instrument. But suddenly I was actually spending time rehearsing it, then more time than developing and tweaking it. Okay. So this is still very simple. The scriptures are very simple, but we have the actually 4 or 5 descriptors that are most important for perception or for distinction of general corpora. So if you want to use this for specific kinds of sounds, ecological sounds, it would probably be good to develop specific descriptors for it. But already with the simple set, what do we have? We have loudness, pitch, periodicity, degree of noisiness, the centroid, the brilliance of the signal. With that set alone, it's already pretty. You can get a good resolution, a good general view of any sound corpus. I think we'll look into the example corpora later. But let's just show a few examples. Okay, present that. So for those who know granular synthesis, there's the obvious link that you could see the corpus-based synthesis as a content-based extension of granular synthesis, because you choose the grains not only by position in time, but by actual content. Specify what you want to hear, what kind of grain you want to hear. And for you humanities folks, I should. There is a link to Lev Manovich's work, who postulates that finally the database is a new art form. And so, corpus is a sound database, so it might fall into that scheme. Okay, so Cathart is our team's implementation of the principle of corpus-based synthesis. There are others. There's Tom Reidy for PD, Alex Harker wrote external for Maximus P that do pretty much the same thing. And there must be few more, but of course here at IRCAM there's now these three versions of Cathart. So what you saw was the standalone application made of Max, that is based on the classic version of Cathart with a very very low level extension for Max, which I would not advise you to use. But there's a new technical basis for Cathart that Alice showed you already, based on the moving stars, and that's completely free, but the download is via the IRCAM forum. So for those who want to try out things, you can head over to our team's page that will point you to the forum page where you can download the moving stars, and there's a second package with examples, and the new Cathart is part of that.
A question?
Yeah.
Do they come with a runtime version of Max, or do you need a Max to work with it? I mean, the
you can run examples just with the runtime. Otherwise, there's no distinction anymore.
There's no runtime.
Okay.
You just install Max 7, and you just can't save patches. You can actually even edit.
Okay.
Okay, a few examples So this is my main artistic practice is actually recording the corpus live. So starting a concert with a improvisation partner with no sound at all, and then constituting everything live. And that's also a very nice example, I think, of algorithmic listening for the arts, because, you know, I have these descriptors that listen to the sound for me and kind of make a bit of sense of the sound that is coming in. And so I can recreate meaning, because everything that happens during the concert will end up in the corpus, but it will be disposed in a way that I can recreate new structures and meaningfully select an answer to my improvisational partner or transform what he played. And this creates a very, very direct coupling, I think, between the two musicians, because we kind of, instead of classic improvisation, where the coupling takes place in the space of musical structures and harmonies and melodies, we have this the concrete sound space, and so this becomes actually a kind of symbiotic shared instrument. The sound space that is nourished by the instrument and I feed off from that sound space. So I'll show you one very old example, but it's very nice because it has a 3D visualization of the corpus as it is built up. So here the segmentation is by note. And every played note will be inserted into the corpus and also visualized according to, of course, some characters mapped to position and angle and color and size of these feathers. And then at some point I can start playing off from the corpus. And of course it builds up and builds up and builds up again. Until I have lots of choices in the end. Yeah, that's what I mostly do in duo or two quartets settings. I don't do this in the orchestra because that's too complicated. So there I rather use actually environmental recordings, big recordings that I play with, and finally, I have just a few corpora that I know them very well, that I could probably play without actually looking at the interface. And it's also an interesting turn for me to notice that I don't need to go the path that usually electronic musicians go, where the sound design is the main way of expression, so for each set, for each concert, they would make new sounds. I kind of was able to get away from that because the main means of expression is the gesturality of the sounds. So I can play the same sounds like a saxophone player. You wouldn't ever hear someone say to a saxophone player, "Oh, you're coming again with these saxophone sounds." Never change the sounds, or so I can assume having an instrument and be expressive by how I use it, not how I program the sound. Okay, one last example of corpus-based synthesis for the arts. That's a great project with the designers like you saw David in Pelerin of User Studio. And they came up with the idea, what could a dirty tangible instrument be? And so dirty in the sense that it's not a clean mouse or fader or button, so it's something that you change. And you change and it's irreversible. And so how to realize this? After lots of studies, they came up with this camera-tracked bowl of granular materials. Of course, they also like a graphic representation of what is happening. So that's the tracking view. And we were lucky to apply this in the 104 Cultural Center in Paris. There's a very nice space for children.
Quand je regarde, je m'entends une oiseau. C'est une forêt.
À toi.
So the iPad is just a control surface to change one of the 8 musical universes and volume, but the tracking is just a camera underneath that tracks the transparency. This material is tapioca beads. They're very nice to touch. And on this rectangular surface, there are kind of virtual sound grains of sound horns that span that space. And whenever there's movement on top of one of these kind of virtual points, the grain is activated. And because it's a sound corpus, that means that there's a kind of logical disposition. You know, you go from muddle to brilliant sound, from smooth to noisy sounds. So there's a logical layout that you can learn, and you can also play in a rather directed way, as we'll see. Thank you. team colleagues who of course worked also on my software for everything I've shown, especially Norbert Schneider, Ricardo Borghese, Federico Villa. So thanks to them. Thanks for your attention. Immediate questions right now? It's back.
You made a conscious choice to always apply a descriptor to this sound space, this mapping. Have you ever thought about letting the kind of density of what's in the data set kind of speak for itself and reveal its own sort of descriptions of what are the most variable axes of that program?
Oh, applying PCA. Yeah.
Yeah.
A lot about it, and we can implement that too. But there is something to be said to use an estimation, a dimension that you know the meaning.
Right.
You know pitch, you know loudness. So for a musician, I think it's okay to go for the meaningful dimensions. For an installation visitor, it's great to just have a sound work laid out and you can explore it quickly in the most variable dimension. So both have merits. But what I actually want to get through is that for the sound browsing application, ecological acoustics, the most important point is the interaction. It's not the layout, because this is obviously much too simplistic. There are much better ways nowadays, TSNE, whatever, to really make sense of high dimensional data and lay this out in 2D. But you really need to be able to quickly browse and quickly discover that this is silent, that this was the vowels and these were the fricatives.
Right.
So even a very complex space with many, many clusters, well, you can go through them and immediately listen to what is in there. And that's the difference between just having numbers or a collection of sound files where it's so tedious to listen to one after the other.
How do you do this segmentation?
Here it was just regular.
Fixed time,
yeah.
Slices?
Okay.
Always, or do you have any?
There is, in the mobile version, there's onset detection, silent segmentation, and all the script analysis is now kind of separate framework that is open to extensions for everyone.
Because you could also use the descriptors to actually inform the segmentation, right? So if you do that analysis first, then you can do more intelligent segmentation.
Novelty detection or so?
Yeah, well, I mean, looking at some kind of total change or change over several descriptors and then slice there, for example.
Absolutely possible. Yeah, in MUBI you can try this one, but I'll leave that for the more workshopy part, maybe. Because I think Patrick.
So in Kupacher had T of 3 on 4. I go down to have coffee now. You've got coffee in an hour. Is everyone still alive?
Yeah.
We have like 5 minutes.
That's a little stand up and move around.
Yeah. A few minutes.
Do you move around a little bit?
Yeah.
Because this last session is pretty freeform. I just quickly post up the stuff that I've put online, which was some really, really simple questions around how we might use techniques like this or similar to no databases, and how we might use machine is being quite straightforward feature analysis in new contexts. So look at these conversational dynamics. So let's have like 5 minutes breathing and stretching. I'll just put up those questions really quickly. Show you very quickly what happens. So I put up an archive as an example of it. Well, I'll say on the top, I'm fine with it. And then Patrice has got a little something to show us before he has to dash off the floor. So I guess to return to some like quite simple conceptual and practical issues at the end of some much more complex and abstract talking, we set a couple of what I'd rather flippantly call feature surfing challenges. So just look at these ways. Can we ask new questions which we couldn't do before in other ways with listening, machine listening, and can machine listening perhaps help us hear in new ways? So the first one was exactly what I've just been talking about. If we've got a large database of audio, can we visualise or perceptualise those features in a way that helps us know the database in a useful way? So in sales giving context, for example, pull out or cluster or visualise or quickly identify some relevant features. So animal sounds versus weather versus the sounds of machines, for example. Can we see silent or distorted files? So quite straightforward questions in terms of managing and working with the audio databases. And then I'll move quickly over that picture because we want to dwell on it. Sadly, my colleague from the lab couldn't be here today, but I've got various colleagues working in oral history, and they were really quite excited about the idea that you could use machine listening to analyse corpuses of oral history interviews, and for example, to look at things like gender-based conversational dynamics. So this idea that perhaps women and men interrupt each other in different ways. So Chris and I and some others from the lab ran a few workshops in some humanities contexts last year, and did a really, really quick with a sample size of one, showed that you could separate this French woman and this very, very pompous English man, even actually just with two features. You didn't have to do any clustering or any PCAs or anything. Just very quickly, you can very quickly see differences. And Chris looked at the MFCC for looking at transition points, and you could quickly identify where the turn taking happened. So that seems like quite a possible and simple application, which might be quite interesting to people in cultural studies, gender studies, etc. I'm going to just flick. Or Dima, were you going to demonstrate this with the corpus in? No, they've just got a group in. But if you wanted to do it, I don't want to steal your thunder because it works quite well. So basically, maybe Dima shows this quickly. I think Patrice has looked at the environmental recording archives with the project you've done previously. Daniel's just whipped up a long form spectrogram. And Farag, you've had a look at something.
Yeah. How does it deal with overlapping data points? How does it deal with overlapping data points? Does it just play back both files simultaneously? Do they never overlap?
One or the other will be closest.
Okay.
Just it is very simplistic. Okay, so for the DOM cars, I would.
Can you replug your HDMI cable or something?
Something
weird.
That's better.
Much better.
Yeah,
it is better. Thank you.
Yes, I would say I wouldn't go for 1 minute slices. I would really go for slices of maybe 2 seconds.
2 seconds
is the length of a sheep vocalization, isn't it? So you've got a meaningful unit and you can listen to it in its entirety. But then even when you take 10-second slices, it might be, you get less points, but then you can't listen to the 10 seconds by browsing through. And so River or Dawn Chorus? Any?
Doesn't matter.
Do the river. River.
The river's a bit clearer than you.
Okay, so we throw
this. You get a bit around.
And now, of course, we do have to wait a little bit.
Sort of 1:40-ish, that's when the thunder kicks off. Maybe it's just.
And so. Yeah, it's kind of pretty fast, but 3 hours is a lot. I did make sure I run it in 64-bit, because otherwise the 32-bit max has about 2.5 gigabytes of actually usable memory. And that is full pretty quickly with that type of camera. But the nice thing is we can already play while it is analyzing the rest. Can already browse and see, okay, this is birds. And that's what I meant, you know. Time is just another descriptor for us. We kind of relegated time to one dimension of our descriptor space. Of course I can use time here for display. Now this is in time, just that, constantly expanding. Give it a little bit of a... It's also readjusting. But this is this whole thing in time, descriptor, well, periodicity in time. Of course, that's not a very useful visualization. Noisiness, and we could use time as color, so we kind of see the progression in over time as in this color scale. So blue is the early stuff. Standalone because it has a nicer interface. It's better for demoing, but all the features are. Some features are not yet in Mubu.
Yeah.
But there are other things in Mubu that are not here that are much better. But for a simple demo, this is just a bit more convenient. There's, for example, okay, if you really want to know details while you're browsing, then you can use this little. Inspector. That just shows. All the very details of a unit you point at. So exactly what file this came from. And exactly what time in the file. So that way you can then really inspect what you're listening to. Outside of Max, that might go a bit faster, but it's still okay. And so, yeah, then of course you would have some zooming. I should really wait until the 3 hours are in there. True dimensionality reduction algorithm that would take into account all the perceptual dimensions, when they're close, that would mean they really sound the same. Here it might not be the case because we're just projecting onto two descriptors. But better visualizations for this, that would not be a problem. Okay, we're done. What else could be informative here in this corpus?
I find pushing in, I think I've got about 30 of them, and really quickly you've got different species. You have the pheasants there, the rooks there, the wood pigeons there, the rain there, quiet wind, and then the massive storm. And they all just fell into these separate places.
Okay. Which ones are the pheasants?
So, what do they look like?
The sound, what do they sound
like?
There you go.
That was
good.
These ones
are
crowds.
Loudness and pitch to the right. Loudness and why?
Loudness and frequency, and then coloured by periodicity, which is really good. Then it's about the verticals from the brain.
Quite a nice way of working out which features you can use to separate your sounds and then inform your future matching.
Okay. So we know that these two features are related, which is pretty obvious because it's pitch. It's related too. Actually, I really think periodicity is as good as a dimension too.
Any rain, and then I put in a section where I knew there was some rain and wind, and that's probably my suffering.